As you all know, we're in the middle of the second week of the lockdown in the NCR Plus bubble, and we're receiving reports, as you just saw, of government aid not being properly distributed, or worse, not even reaching residents. We're going to check in on the country's largest city. Joining us now, Joy Belmonte. She's mayor of Quezon City. Mayor Belmonte, good afternoon to you, and welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina, and good afternoon to everyone listening to our program today.
Okay, I want to jump off from the report that we just ran. How would you explain the mismanagement that happened there? The queue, the lines were so long, people coming out empty-handed. What's the explanation for the mismanagement, Mayor?
Well, the way I see it is that, first and foremost, Quezon City has some very large barangays. That's something that no other city has that same problem as us. Now, we have barangays with several hundred thousand residents just in one barangay. That's one issue, and I'll go back to that later. No? But second also is the fact that the national government wants us to finish giving ayuda within 15 days, which in our estimate is a little bit impossible given that we have to give ayuda to about 800,000 families, or equivalent to about 2.48 million individuals. That poses a challenge because we have also to take care of making sure that the minimum health standards are followed. So the way I understood the Batasan incident, and incidentally that's probably one or two of about 40 barangays that we handled yesterday. So it's not the norm. It was an aberration. But the way I see it is probably because of the size of the barangay and also because of the speed at which we have to distribute this ayuda to be able to comply with the deadline of the national government. The barangays who are in charge of mobilizing the people probably had a hard time trying to convince the people to come in groups, no, as we had instructed them. Because we told the barangays, you know, we have to make sure that there's minimum health standards. Can you please have a maximum of only 2,000 people come each day, and then give them stubs. And then everyone who doesn't have a stub should not be coming on that day. And the stub should contain different information. For example, people with a certain last name should come at a certain time, or people coming from a certain street should come at a certain time. That's to make sure that there's staggered attendance and that the people don't all rush to one place at any given time. The barangay had a difficult time. With their system. And then second, of course, is the fact that people are hungry, they're in need, they've lost their jobs, and they're desperate. So given a situation when they hear there is ayuda, many of them do not wait for the system to be implemented anymore. They just try their luck and line up. No? Now, given that situation, I've had a meeting with my team earlier today, and I told them we all agree that we have to take extra steps to prevent similar incidences from happening, especially in our very, very big barangays, where the population are extremely poor and extremely in need.
Yeah, because, you know, when you compare the situation now to last year, it's very different. These people have lost their jobs for a longer period of time now. So it's similar but different. So did you get the assurance from the barangay officials that this will not happen again, that they should be better prepared next time around, Mayor?
Yes, I did. I spoke to the barangay captain already, and of course, I don't also want to pin the blame on the barangay. It's everyone's responsibility, including the local government, and I will take full responsibility for that side of things where we missed out on, especially in terms of information dissemination, and also the fact that when we print out payrolls, no, Carmina, and each payroll, if we come from a smaller barangay, it's easy to print out a payroll with 4,000 names, 3,000 names, but when you're printing payroll with hundreds of thousands of names, it takes quite a lot of time as well. There are also manpower challenges, etc. But these are things now that we have taken into account. We charge it to first day glitches, and hopefully these will not be repeated anymore in the succeeding days, because we are very well aware of what has to be done already to avoid them.
Yeah, but is it just really it's just a matter of processes here, Mayor, and not the lack of funds? You still have the funds. It's just the matter of dispersing it.
Oh, yeah. The funds are, we actually have a lot of funds, and we're very grateful for the national government because they really did think about the demographics and the profile of the people in Quezon City. And I think we have sufficient funds to take care of the people who belong to the low-income brackets, who have lost their jobs, who are no work, no pay, people who were fired and have finished their separation pay, people who come from vulnerable sectors. Based on our calculations, there is enough funds to cover for everyone's needs. So that is not the problem. And that's probably one thing I would also like to appeal to the people of Quezon City, that they don't have to rush. They don't. It's not a first-come, first-served basis. There is no threat that they will not be given assistance. The list comes from DSWD. It has been cleaned up. It has been studied. Other people who are not on that list, we have added to. These include the people who used to have or who used to accept help from the LTFRB, from the DOLE, from the SSS, from the Social Pension Fund of the Senior Citizens. Now they will not be receiving from these agencies anymore. So we have included them as well in the SAP 2021. So people should not worry that they will be left behind. We have made sure that there is enough for everyone, and maybe they should just have faith that the government is looking after them. And also, in addition to that, all of the names are posted as part of our transparency and accountability measures. They will be posted. They are posted already as we speak in our Facebook page in the barangays as well. And we have a grievance committee in every site where people can actually appeal if they believe they did not receive enough, or if they feel that they have been aggrieved in a certain way. They can appeal and they can make their voices be heard, and they will be listened to.
Mayor, very quickly on this topic before we go on to the next, you say you have enough funds, but if the ECQ restrictions are extended, maybe until the end of April, if that is a possibility, will you have enough funds to last until then?
Well, with regards to the national government, I'm not so sure. I think we have to discuss this with the national government. But last I heard from them, I think this is as far as they're able to give us at the moment. And this is the reason why when people ask me also, Mayor Joy, are you going to augment the 1,000 per individual or the 4,000 per family, I say let us first try to make the funds of the national government fit, because we don't know how long this pandemic will last. It might last even beyond April. We can have a third surge in the middle of the year, in the latter part of the year. And I think that given the situation in the national government level, the local governments have to step up if this pandemic is prolonged. And therefore, whatever I set aside, I would like to set aside for the time being, because I would like to make sure that I can take care of the people of Quezon City should the worst case scenario happen.
Okay, talking about scenario now, what's the scenario there in Quezon City, the COVID situation, latest data that you have? I understand that the mayors of Metro Manila, you're going to meet this Saturday. You're going to see and discuss if, you know, it's ideal for the restrictions to be eased. With the current scenario that you have, with the current COVID situation that you have, are you in favor of the easing of restrictions, Mayor Belmonte?
Well, you know, for me, I always say that this is a health crisis. This requires the interventions of medical professionals. I don't think politicians are the right people who should be answering a question such as whether to extend ECQ or not. Given that, I do always, when I have to vote, I do always refer to the expert opinion of medical professionals before I cast my vote. Now, having said that, here in Quezon City, we are really trying our best. Now, we have about, I would say about 800, 900 new cases a day. Our current active cases are around 10,820. Now, that seems quite a lot. And of course, everyone is always saying Quezon City has the highest number. And that is true. No? But I always want to put this into perspective, because we are the largest city with the biggest population. So I would imagine that being in the epicenter as well, which is NCR, Quezon City would have, in terms of absolute numbers, the highest number. But I also just want to assure the people of Quezon City that in terms of attack rate, which is a more, I would say, fair measure of how well we're doing or how badly we're doing. In terms of attack rate, Quezon City is only 13 out of 17 LGUs in the NCR region. So actually, we have to look at it from that perspective. And that's the reason why I feel that somehow we're still managing. Now, in terms of our quarantine facilities, we have 2,000 beds. Only 62% are occupied at the moment. But having said that, I'm already planning to open another 1,000 beds within this week and next week. Our contact tracing capability is still 1:6, which is still not bad given the surge. We have 36 lockdown areas. This has already gone down from 50. And in terms of testing, we have already entered into agreement with the Red Cross because I want to do more testing. We do test about 4,000 a day. I think that's too little. I'm expanding our testing capability within the next few days. And hopefully all of these taken together will somehow help lower the number further here in Quezon City.
What about government services, Mayor Belmonte? Let's talk about that. How many of the city's officials are infected as we speak, and how has this affected the delivery of service in Quezon City, Mayor?
Well, Carmina, no, we have implemented a skeleton workforce here in Quezon City Hall during the ECQ. However, all the vital services are still being performed, and there are no departments that are crippled. I wanted to make sure that all of the needs of the people are still being met. So in that regard, I think that we're still doing fine. We don't have the very, very high cases of positives that other cities have reported. I guess it's because during the first wave last year, we already experienced that and we've learned our lessons from that. And we are much more careful now compared to before. You know? So we have very few who have COVID compared to before. And the services are still ongoing, especially in terms of the basic services. They are still ongoing, and nothing has been sacrificed in the meantime.
Well, that's good to hear. Now, on to this very important topic, Mayor Belmonte, a congressman in your city is going to distribute ivermectin for free. How are you addressing this, considering the drug may endanger your constituents' lives?
Well, you know, I am not a health professional, so I don't know if I'm the right person to answer this question. I would imagine a legislator knows the law and knows who are the regulating bodies. And I would imagine that prior to volunteering to distribute any kind of drugs, that they have already consulted with the regulating agency, which is the Food and Drug Administration. So I don't think I'm in a position to really comment on that, not being a health professional myself.
But this is the health of your constituents, Mayor Belmonte, and there have been conflicting, at the very least, conflicting views about the use of the drug.
Well, in my, I personally would never recommend a drug that has not been approved by the FDA, which I think we've seen this very, very clearly when we were talking about the vaccines, when now we were trying to address vaccine hesitancy. If you recall, the very first thing that we would tell our people is that we would provide them with vaccines that are efektibo at sigurado, or safe, effective, and safe for the people. No? So I think that is the most important component here. And only the FDA can really say if a drug is safe and effective. So based on that logic that we've applied using the vaccines, I would defer to the FDA to exercise its police powers as well and to bring forward the necessary enforcement agencies if they feel that the law is being violated here and that the health and welfare of the people are being put to risk.
Have you reached out to Congressman Mike Defensor about this? Has he reached out to you about his plan to distribute ivermectin to your constituents, Mayor?
Well, you know, Carmina, this is a political issue because Congressman Defensor is running for mayor in 2022 against me. So I don't think that it's proper for me to reach out to him. He might misinterpret my actions. So I would just like perhaps to I'd probably call on the medical profession to probably reach out to him so that my actions will not be misinterpreted in any way. I don't think this is time for politics, and I don't want my actions to be taken out of context or be seen in a different light. And at the moment, my number one concern is just to look after the health and welfare of our people. So those who are in the proper position in government, perhaps I would like to call on them to probably call on the attention of Secretary of Congressman Defensor if they feel that his actions might in any way endanger the lives of anybody, of any people. And I imagine his contributing ivermectin should not also be just confined to Quezon City because he's a party-less congressman. So I'm assuming he actually should be helping everyone if he believes that it is a drug that will help many people. Or all people, the whole country is afflicted with COVID. So he should probably concentrate on everyone in need if he believes truly that it is a drug that can cure COVID for everyone.
Okay, finally, Mayor Belmonte, about the switch to Sinovac's CoronaVac for senior citizens. After saying AstraZeneca is being reserved for seniors, we now have this FDA decision that allows the use of CoronaVac on senior citizens. Won't this lead to confusion or worse hesitancy among the seniors, at least in your city? How are you addressing this, Mayor?
Well, in Quezon City, we only just heard the news yesterday that Sinovac will be allowed for use by senior citizens. However, we were also told that certain guidelines are going to be crafted by the Department of Health prior to rollout. So we are going to be waiting for these guidelines. And I'm assuming that prior to rollout, the Department of Health will be meeting with the local government unit so that we can have some of our concerns and answers and questions answered before we actually roll them out to our citizens, because I imagine the citizens will themselves be quite wary, quite afraid, they might have fears that need to be allayed. And I think it is up to local government to reassure them that everything will be safe and effective. And before we can do that, we need the word of the Department of Health as well to reassure the local governments first and foremost. So I think that's why it's been moved to or pushed to April 12th. It's so that we can have more information that we in turn can tell our citizens, because at the end of the day, it's our job to reassure them, to keep them safe.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Mayor Joy Belmonte of Quezon City, we appreciate you coming to the program. You keep safe. Take care.
Thank you very much, Carmina.